Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Be turning in your Bibles to the book of 1 Corinthians, chapter 11. Father, we thank you for the privilege of coming once again to break the bread of life. Father, I thank you and I praise you, Lord, for safety. I thank you that the angels of the Lord encamped around about us this night. I thank you for bringing us here safely. I thank you, Father, and I praise you in Jesus' name that your precious Holy Spirit's anointing is in this room. And I yield myself unto him and I say, Holy Spirit, do what you do best, and that is teach us. And I ask you to bring forth this word this night through me, your servant. I yield myself unto you. Just speak through me, place your words in my mouth. And Father, I thank you in advance for what you will do in the hearts and the lives of every person here this night. Father, I thank you that they will not leave here as they came, in Jesus' name. And we thank you and we give you praise for it. In the strong name of your Son, Jesus, we pray, we believe, and we receive. Amen.
Amen.
Amen and amen and amen. Amen. We are covering the New Testament methods of healing. And we have learned that one way, but not the only way, that you can receive healing for your body is by calling for the elders of the church. James chapter 5, verses 14 and 15. Another way, but not the only way, that you can receive healing is by the laying on of hands. The third way that you can receive healing is by having faith in the name of Jesus. And I tell you, that has to be, well, every week that I teach, it's my favorite, but that has got to be my almost favorite, is having faith in the name of Jesus. Acts chapter 3, you remember Peter and John was going into the temple, and the lame man was sitting there begging for alms. And Peter said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And that made the religious leaders mad when that man was healed. And he went with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. And the religious leaders said, by what power or by what name have you done this? And Peter boldly opened his mouth and said, his name, through faith in his name, has given this man this perfect soundness in the presence of you all. It was the name of Jesus that brought healing into that lame man. The fourth way that you can receive healing is by the prayer of agreement. Matthew 18, 19 and 20. Two of you agree on earth as touching anything that they ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there I am in the midst of them. Another way that you can receive healing is by praying the prayer of faith. Mark 11, verses 23 and 24. Another way you can receive your healing is through the gifts of healings. Listed in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 8 through 10, list the nine gifts of the Holy Spirit. And one of those gifts that are listed in 1 Corinthians chapter 12 is gifts of healings. And we studied that last week. Now tonight, we're going to cover the seventh method that you can receive healing for your physical body. And that is by partaking of the Lord's table or communion. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 23 through 25. Let's begin. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. The Word of God says in verse 23, "For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup, and when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament, or the New Covenant, in my blood. This do ye, as oft as ye drink it, in remembrance of me. The bread on the communion table represents the body of our Lord Jesus. His body was broken for us. And the scripture declares in 1 Peter 2:24, by whose stripes, by his stripes, we were healed. 1 Peter 2:24 says, to his own self, bear our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sin, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes ye were healed. Now, I want us to go back and read this whole passage in 1 Corinthians chapter 11 in context, because this passage is one of the most misunderstood passages in the entire New Testament. And the reason is that many preachers preach that if you take communion or the Lord's table unworthily, you will bring damnation upon yourself. And you can even die, they say. And we have gone into great detail studying this passage in our series on communion, so I'm going to only touch on it briefly in this teaching. I want us to take this whole passage in context. And I have listed in your handout verses 20 through 34. But I want to back up to verse 17. And I want to begin reading at verse 17. Paul is writing to the church at Corinth, and he says, now in this that I declare unto you, I praise you not, that ye come together, not for the better, but for the worse. For first of all, when you come together in the church, I hear that there be divisions among you, and I partly believe it. For there must be also heresies among you, that they which are approved may be made manifest among you. Verse 20. When you come together, therefore, into one place, this is not to eat, or ye cannot eat the Lord's Supper. For in eating, everyone taketh before other his own supper, and one is hungry, and another is drunken. What? Have ye not houses to eat and to drink in? Or despise ye the church of God, and shame them which have not? What shall I say to you? Shall I praise you in this? I praise you not. Verse 23. For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he brake it, and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup. And when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye, as oft as ye drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do shew or show the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when ye are judged, ye are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world. Wherefore, my brethren, when you come together to eat, tarry one for another. If any man hunger, let him eat at home, that ye come not together unto condemnation. And the rest will I set in order when I come. This passage is Paul's specific instructions to a church. It was the church at Corinth, concerning the agape meal, or the love feast. In the New Testament, The early church met daily for breaking of bread from house to house. If you want to look that reference up, it's Acts chapter 2, verse 46, if you're taking notes. The early church, the believers, the Christians met daily, and they broke bread together. And in the early church, they had a meal just like we do here. They had a meal first, then communion, then they read letters from the other churches that Paul had written to the other churches. They read the word. They prayed for the needs. All of this was done daily. And this love feast or agape meal preceded or took place before communion. During the love feast, they ignored all distinctions of rank. Those who were poor and those who were wealthy ate together, and they met as one family. And they did away with the custom that they had in those days of the seating arrangements. You remember I've taught you in detail about the seating arrangements, how the rich and the poor would be seated according to rank, according to their degree of importance in the community and in society. But at the agape meal, they put all that aside and they all met as one family and they all ate the meal together. The rich and the poor ate together. But as time went on, the church began to revert back to their normal customs of eating. And the rich began to gather up at the front of the table where all the food was. And the poor were down at the end where they were the furthest away from the food. And the rich were eating all the food and the poor were going hungry. And some of them were even getting drunk. Paul addresses it in this passage. And he's writing, remember, to Christians. So all over the years, the agape, or the love feast, the agape meal was stopped due to abuse, just like in the church of Corinth. And so they eliminated this part of assembling themselves together and breaking bread from house to house. So, over the centuries, communion has evolved to the way we partake of it today, of just having the bread and the cup. We don't have the whole agape meal like they did in the New Testament. But the key is, out of this whole passage, is not to pick out the middle part of the passage and base a whole doctrine on just a portion of this passage. Verses 27 through 29, Paul is not talking about taking communion unworthily. These verses are talking about the agape meal or the love feast, because verses 33 and 34, he continues with the same subject. He says, "Wherefore, my brethren, when you come together to eat, tarry one for another. If any man hunger, let him eat at home, that ye come not together unto condemnation. And the rest will I set in order when I come." Now, I want you to look back in verse 29. See that word, damnation? "For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself." This word damnation is the same Greek word that is translated condemnation down in verse 34. Do you see that word? Condemnation. The King James translator should have translated them the same word, because it's the same Greek word. If you look it up in a Greek concordance, those two words, damnation, condemnation, is the same Greek word. And I also want you to look in verse 29 at that word unworthily. Did you know that word is not in the original Greek language? This word has been added by the King James translators. If you look at that verse closely, that word unworthily, and also lords, L-O-R-D-S, look at it, not discerning the Lord's body. That word lords is also not in the original Greek. Now I want you to look at this verse, and we're going to read it just as it was written in the original Greek. Verse 29, for he that eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, eateth and drinketh, not discerning the body. Notice the word lords is not in this verse, in the original Greek. He that eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, eateth and drinketh, not discerning the body. It's talking about the body of Christ, your brothers and sisters. It's talking about the church. It's not talking about the Lord's body. Like verse 26, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do shew the Lord's death till he come. Paul is referring in this verse, in verse 26, to the bread and the cup of the communion table. But in verse 27, he is talking about the body of the Lord. And it's just been so confused over the years by preachers just picking out this middle portion and basing a whole doctrine and saying, oh, you cannot eat and drink the Lord's communion unworthily. If you do, you'll eat and drink and you'll bring damnation upon yourself and you could get sick and you could die. You have to take the whole passage in context. Paul is addressing the church at Corinth. They were being gluttonous. Some of them were getting drunk. And he said, you're not discerning the body, not the Lord's body. You're not discerning the body, the church, your brothers and your sisters. And that is why Paul said that some of you are weak, some of you are sick, and some of you are even dying. Can you see that? I want you to see that you are worthy to partake of communion. The Lord Jesus has made you worthy. His death, amen, on the cross, he shed his blood to make you worthy. This is an honor. It is a privilege that you have been provided. You are worthy to partake of the Lord's table. And I could spend a lot more time breaking this down, but I hope that you have seen just from what I've covered that Paul is addressing one entire subject, not just communion. He's addressing the agape meal, the love feast. All of this whole passage, he's addressing this one subject. Now, you're not going to get drunk and you're not going to be gluttonous if you just take one piece of bread, one bite of bread, and one sip of the cup, are you? No, but Paul was saying, hey, some of you are eating all the food and some are going hungry. And if you are that hungry, you eat at home before you come and don't be getting drunk at the Lord's house. Amen. That's what he's saying. Can you see that?
Yeah.
I know most of you here have not heard me cover this in detail, and I don't have time to break it down like I would normally if I was spending an entire teaching on it, because I got too much more to cover. So I hope you see that clearly. Do you?
Yeah.
One subject,
yeah,
the agape meal, is what is being addressed in this whole passage. And you are worthy to take communion. The blood of Jesus Christ has made you worthy. Now look back one chapter in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 16. The Word of God says, the cup of blessing which we bless, is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? The bread which we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? Jesus instituted what we celebrate today as communion at the Last Supper that he had with his disciples. Turn to the book of Luke, chapter 22. Luke, chapter 22, verses 15 through 20. Jesus was in the upper room with his disciples. This was their last meal together while Jesus was on earth before he was going to the cross. Luke chapter 22, beginning in verse 15. And he said unto them, "With desire I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say unto you, I will not eat any more eat thereof until it be fulfilled in the kingdom of God." And he took the cup and gave thanks and said, "Take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say unto you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God shall come." And he took bread and gave thanks and brake it and gave unto them, saying, "This is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." Likewise also the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you." The cup represents the blood of Jesus. And the bread on the communion table represents the body of our Lord Jesus. In John chapter 6, 35, Jesus said, speaking of himself, he said, "I am the bread of life." John 6, 35, look at your handout. And Jesus said unto them, "I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger, and he that believeth on me shall never thirst." What did Jesus call himself? The bread of life. The bread on the communion table that we serve is a picture of the body of our Lord. We use matzah bread. And this bread is a picture of the Lord Jesus' body. There are three distinctive things about Jewish matzah bread. It's unleavened. Leaven in Scripture is a type of sin. And Jesus was perfect. He was sinless. He was pure. This bread is unleavened, representing the Lord's body. This bread is pierced. Jesus said, Zechariah 12:10 and John 19:37, "They shall look on him whom they pierced." Jesus is quoting in John 19:37 from the Old Testament book of Zechariah. The prophet Zechariah looked ahead in time to Jesus on the cross. And he prophesied hundreds of years before Jesus came and went to the cross. Zechariah 12:10 prophesied about Jesus being pierced. And in John chapter 19, verse 34, you find that the soldier pierced Jesus' side with the sword. So this bread is pierced. It has holes in it. It represents the body of our Lord Jesus. And this bread is also striped. And we've already read in 1 Peter 2:24, the Word of God says, "With his stripes ye were healed." The Word was made flesh, John chapter 1 says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us." Jesus became the Word. The Word was made flesh, and the flesh was made striped. And with his stripes, we are healed. In Luke chapter 22, verses 15 through 20 that we just read, at this time was when Jesus instituted what we celebrate today as communion. And at this meal that he was celebrating with his disciples, he was celebrating the Passover meal. And we have studied this time after time about the first Passover that ever took place was in the Old Testament, back in the book of Exodus, chapter 12, when God brought the children of Israel out of Egyptian bondage. As they ate the Passover meal, as they placed the lamb in their mouths, healing came into their bodies. As they ate that lamb 3,500 years ago on that first Passover night, healing came into their bodies. And today, as we come to the communion table and as we eat this lamb, healing comes into our bodies. On that first Passover night back in Exodus chapter 12, approximately 2.5 million Jews ate that Passover lamb that night. And every one of them that was sick was healed. Every single one of them that had any kind of sickness in their body was healed. Think of it. 2.5 million people, as they ate the lamb, were healed. How do we know this? We've covered it time after time. Look at your handout. Psalms chapter 105, verse 37 says, "He brought them forth also with silver and gold, and there was not one feeble person among their tribes." Not one. Not one. Not one. As they placed that lamb in their mouth, healing came into their bodies. And as we take communion today, and as we place this lamb in our mouths, healing comes into our bodies, just like it did on that first Passover night when they ate the lamb. Communion is a wonderful way that you can receive healing for your physical body. And you don't have to wait until we have communion here at church. You can have communion at home. And I have communion often, just me and the Lord. I keep the bread and I keep the wine. I just keep that bread in my freezer. And just me and the Lord will have communion. And you can do this at home. And numerous times over the years, if I have had sickness in my body, I have gone to the communion table at home and I have received communion. I have taken the Lord's body and His blood and received healing. Why? Because the bread represents His body. The bread on the communion table represents Jesus, our Lamb, our Passover Lamb, whose body was pierced and whose body was striped. The Word was made flesh, and the flesh was made striped. And with His stripes, we are healed. Communion is the meal that heals. Chuck Swindoll, he is a well-known minister. And I heard him years ago tell this story. He told the story of a little boy in Germany after the end of World War II. The war had ended, and this little boy was an orphan because of the war. And this little boy was standing outside on a cold winter day. He was standing outside of a donut shop. And it was cold outside, but it was warm inside that donut shop. And the little boy took his sleeve and he wiped the glass off the, wiped that steam off the glass on that window. And he peered in to that window, and he was looking and longing for a donut, because he was hungry. He was an orphan. He was homeless. And he was so hungry as he stood peering into that donut shop. And a soldier came, and as he was walking by, he looked at that little boy looking in through that window. And the soldier stopped, and then he went in through the door of that donut shop, and he went and he bought 6 piping hot, fresh, out of the oven donuts. He had the baker to put those donuts in a bag. The soldier came outside, came back through the door, came outside to where that little boy was still standing, peering through the window. And the soldier walked up to the little boy, and he handed the little boy that bag of donuts. And that little boy clutched those donuts to his chest, and he looked up at that big soldier standing before him, and he said, "Mister, be ye God?" That's a picture of us. We were standing outside.
That's right.
In the rubble, in the dirt, in the filth of life. But God came by, and he went inside for us, and he did business for us so that we could eat a meal. God sent his son Jesus to pay the price for us so that we could eat that meal. Jesus bought us a meal called communion, and we can eat it free. But it cost our Lord Jesus a great price. It cost him every drop of his blood, and it cost him the flesh that was on his body. With his stripes, we are healed. Don't you see? We were just like that little boy. We were Gentiles. We were outside the covenant of promise. And as I thought on that story, I could just see in my mind's eye, and I asked Bill if he had a glass door that we could use for an illustration tonight. I could just see you and I standing on this side of that glass door, peering in, but having no access through the door, having no way into the covenant blessings that the Jewish people were entitled to. We were strangers. We were foreigners. We were outside the covenant of promise. And then in my mind's eye, I could picture Jesus walking up to that glass door, opening that door, walking through, stepping back, and then motioning for us to come through that door.
Amen.
Jesus is the door. He said, "I am the door."
Yeah.
And he provided a new and a living way for us through the veil of his flesh that we could enter in through him, the door.
Right.
And we could enter into the new covenant blessings that are provided in through that door. We don't have to stand on this side of the door like that little boy looking longingly through that glass, but having no access to go in and eat that meal, even though he was starving to death. We had no access and no right to the covenant blessings of the children of promise, but Jesus became the door, and he made a way for us.
Amen.
Through the veil of his flesh, shedding his blood so that we could enter in through the door of salvation, and so that we could have abundance instead of lack. We could have blessings instead of cursings.
Amen.
And we could have healing for our bodies instead of sickness.
Right.
Jesus provided a way. He is the door into the new covenant. He shed his blood. He went in through that door to provide salvation and all of the covenant promises that go with it. He went in through that door. He did business for us. He died on the cross for us. He went to hell in our place. And he arose victorious over death, hell, and the grave, all for us, so that we could eat a meal. So that we could come to the communion table and partake of his body and partake of his blood and receive everything that is ours as a covenant child. We can partake of that meal that Jesus provided for us and receive healing in our bodies.
Right.
Communion is the meal that heals.
Amen.
Turn to the book of Isaiah. Isaiah chapter 53. The prophet Isaiah was looking ahead 750 to 800 years before Jesus came to earth. And he saw what would take place that day that Jesus was crucified. Isaiah chapter 53, verses 1 through 7. The word of God says, "Who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness, and when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord had laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. This is the price that our Lord Jesus paid for the meal that you and I can partake of freely. That covenant meal of communion. This is the price that our Lord Jesus paid to become the door for us to enter into the new covenant and be born again. And just as that little boy looked up at that soldier and said, "Mister, be ye God," we can look at the price that Jesus paid. And we turn to him and say, "Be ye God?" And he says, "Yes.
Yes.
And I paid the price for you to eat this meal. I died. I shed my blood on the cross so that you could eat a meal. I paid the price for you. And when you eat that meal, you're entitled to all of the covenant blessings. And one of those blessings is healing for your body." Like I said, Isaiah, the prophet Isaiah, spoke this prophecy 750 to 800 years before Jesus came to earth, lived, and went to the cross and died. This whole prophecy in chapter 53 is speaking about Jesus, who is our Lamb. And with his stripes, we are healed. The bread on the communion table is striped. It's a picture of our Lord Jesus' body. The stripes were placed on Jesus' physical body by the whip of that Roman soldier. And those stripes that those soldiers placed upon Jesus' back was for our healing. Look at verse 4. Let's read it again. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. The word griefs, look at it. That word griefs in the Hebrew is number 2483 in the original Hebrew language, and that Hebrew word is C-H-O-L-I-Y. And that word means sickness. If you look it up in the Brown, Driver, and Briggs Hebrew lexicon, which lists every Hebrew word in our Bible, this word griefs in that Hebrew lexicon means sickness. In the New Testament, Matthew speaks of this prophecy. The book of Matthew speaks of this prophecy spoken by Isaiah hundreds of years before Jesus came to earth. And Matthew makes it clear that Jesus bore our sicknesses. In Matthew chapter 8, verse 17, the word says that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by Isaiah the prophet, saying, himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. Isaiah, look at it. Matthew says, this is being fulfilled, which was a prophecy spoken by the prophet Isaiah. Isaiah said, himself took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses. E.W. Kenyon, in his book, Jesus the Healer, E.W. Kenyon says that Jesus was actually made sin with our sin. He took upon himself our sin. Jesus was made sin with our sin, and he was made sick with our sicknesses. Think about that. He took our sin. You hear a lot of preaching about him taking our sin and providing forgiveness for us of our sin. But Jesus also took our sicknesses. It was our disease, our sickness, that Jesus carried to the whipping post. And it was our sins that hung Jesus on the cross. The psalmist David saw this. Did you know that David was a prophet? He was a psalmist. He was a shepherd. He was the king of Israel, but he was also a prophet. The book of Psalms, chapter 129, and verse 3. Psalms 129, and verse 3. The psalmist David writes, the plowers plowed upon my back. They made long their furrows. David's not speaking about himself. He is speaking prophetically. He is seeing in the realm of the Spirit. He is seeing what is going to happen to the Lord Jesus. He's speaking prophetically about Jesus' back being plowed by the whip. That whip that those Roman soldiers beat our Lord Jesus. That whip made long furrows in Jesus' flesh. Jesus' flesh his body was striped by that whip, and the bread on the communion table is striped to represent Jesus' flesh. And the word says, with his stripes we are healed.
Amen.
The word was made flesh, and the flesh was made striped. And with his stripes we are healed. Look at Psalms chapter 22. Psalms chapter 22. This psalm is known as the crucifixion psalm. Again, the psalmist David is not referring to himself. These things that he is describing are not happening. Verses 16 through 18. The word says, "For dogs have compassed me, the assembly of the wicked have enclosed me. They pierced my hands and my feet. I may tell all my bones. They look and stare upon me." Look at verse 18. "They part my garments among them and cast lots upon my vesture." Who did this happen to?
Jesus.
Did it happen to King David? No. David could not have been referring to himself in this psalm. This psalm is a prophecy concerning our Lord Jesus. It's called the crucifixion psalm. Look at verse 17 again. "I may tell all my bones." Jesus' flesh was slashed so deeply by that whip that his bones were exposed. David prophesied this 950 years before Jesus died on the cross. Isaiah, in his prophecy in Isaiah chapter 53, lived 750 to 800 years before Jesus was born. But the psalmist David lived 950 years before Jesus came to earth to live and to die. And David prophesied this 950 years before it happened. He saw Jesus being scourged, being whipped. He saw Jesus hanging on the cross. Matthew tells us that they scourged or whipped Jesus. Matthew chapter 27, verse 26. The word says, "Then released he Barabbas unto them, and when he had what? Scourged Jesus. He delivered him to be crucified." Jesus was scourged. He was whipped. God the Father placed sickness upon his son Jesus to fulfill the prophecy in his word. In Psalms and in Isaiah, we read it in Isaiah chapter 53, verse 5, "But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed." As horrible as Mel Gibson's film, The Passion of the Christ, as horrible as that film portrayed the scourging, the beating, the whipping of our Lord Jesus, it was no comparison to what our Savior really went through and what his body really looked like according to the scripture. Turn back to Isaiah chapter 52. Isaiah chapter 52. Most of you have seen the movie The Passion, and it's the most gripping movie I've ever seen in my life. But it was nothing as horrible as it was portrayed. It was nothing like what really took place when our Lord Jesus was scourged and when he was hung on the cross. Isaiah chapter 52, verse 14. The prophet Isaiah is again looking down the corridor of time and seeing Jesus. And he said, "As many were astonished," the King James translated that word oddly. You could say, "As many were astonished at thee." His visage was so marred more than any man, and his form more than the sons of men. Some of the other translations translates this more vividly, more clearly. I put a couple of them in your handout. The NIV, the New International Version, says of Isaiah 52:14, "Just as there were many who were appalled at him, his appearance was so disfigured beyond that of any man, and his form marred beyond human likeness." That's what our Jesus went through to provide the meal that we can eat, the meal of communion. The Living Bible says of Isaiah chapter 52, verse 14, "They shall see my servant beaten and bloodied, so disfigured one would scarcely know it was a person standing there." That's what our Lord looked like. He didn't look human anymore. He didn't look like a human being standing there. He was beaten. He was bloodied. He was bruised more than any other human has ever been before or since. Those looking upon Jesus that day saw something so horrible, so disfigured, that it did not even look human anymore. That's what our Lord Jesus went through. That's what he did to provide this meal that you and I can eat so freely. I want to read you a quote from Perry Stone Jr.'s book entitled Healing Power Through Christ. And it's so hard for me to read this. It's the most vivid description of the cross, the beating, that I have ever read. Perry Stone writes, and I quote, "Go with me now into the ages past, to the whipping block. Christ's hands were tied to a metal ring at a 2.5-foot post protruding from the ground. His legs were jerked back as his back was laying bare as an open target for cruel torture. And the strong hand of a Roman legionnaire was a cat of 9 tails. It had a short handle with about a dozen leather cords and jagged pieces of bone or metal at each end to make each blow more effective and painful. The blows were applied to the bare back, the loins, and sometimes the face and the bowels. Historians often say the intestines would be exposed because of the deep cuts and furrows made by the sharp bone and metal. Often, historians say, the victim bit his tongue in two due to the pain, or even fainted. Yet Isaiah tells us, he was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. Blow after blow came crashing down upon the back of heaven's lamb, yet he spoke not a word. He was scourged 39 times, leaving up to 468 marks across his body. Harry Stone says, "A doctor told me that every disease and sickness known in the world stems from 39 major diseases. Christ bore them all in his body. Each time that Roman legionnaire brought that object down, producing bloody marks on the Lamb of God's body. Little did he realize the impact. Little did he realize the impact that was taking place in the spiritual world. With each crashing blow, it meant that someday cancer cells would die, leukemia would be destroyed, crippled limbs would be restored, all because of the blood flowing from Christ's back. With his stripes, we are healed. 1 Peter 2:24. The work that Christ did and the blood which passed from the Lamb's spotless flesh is our healing fountain. End quote. At the communion table, when we place that bread that is pierced and striped, when we place that bread in our mouth, we're placing the Lamb in our mouth. And healing comes into our bodies because the Lamb bore our sicknesses in his own body. And with his stripes, we are healed. The stripes on that bread represent the stripes that Jesus bore on his body. The Word was made flesh. The flesh was made striped. And with his stripes, we are healed. Communion is the meal that heals. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.